Shepherd Center. It reminds me so much of a hospice. Anybody want to defend that? What's a hospice? Lucky you haven't had to deal with that either. Hospice is for patients that are truly at end of life process.
Right.
They're about to transition. Shepherd Center, we're not about transitioning or end of life. I'm about restoring hope, rebuilding lives. So what on earth was she putting together here? It made no sense. But she actually made a good point. And it was all about our patient's emotional status. So many people are blown away, scared to death, frightened of the future, so much so that they come through our doors, she said, feeling as though they were in the life process, because they're assuming everything they had planned for themselves is no longer achievable. It becomes our job as a hospital to prove them otherwise.
Right.
Now that I like and got behind, but our whole goal is to make your day better, right? To make your life better following this injury. That's a building, nice picture. There are 12,500 new cases each year in the United States. That's based on numbers in 2014. I doubt they are significantly different. Does that sound like a large number? 12,000 people all getting a spinal cord injury today. Would you want to be one? No. How about 276,000 people living as a spinal cord injured person each year? Sound like a big number? What if the population of America is 314 million? And you compare that to 276,000, that's the percentage, and it's not statistically a large number, right? And I think maybe that's part of the explanation as to why in the 70s there wasn't a lot of people spending time on this patient population. You could argue that it wasn't until Christopher Reeve, do y'all remember Superman? Right, he played Superman in the 1979 movie. In the mid-90s, he fell off a horse, broke his neck, and suddenly it was a huge media deal. Superman can't walk. And suddenly everybody was interested in spinal cord injury and how to make a spinal cord injured person's life better. The age right now, well, the average in 2010 had gone up to 42 years of age as an average. The spinal cord injury happened to infants, toddlers, adolescents, people your age, adults and seniors. Absolutely, it can happen to anybody. More often than not, it's going to be a male versus a female. There are one, two, three. Guys, tell me why. Why are 79% of spinal cord injuries male?
I assume guys have been more stupid decisions.
See, wait, it's always stupid. Always stupid is always in there somewhere. Let's say they participate in activities that maybe have more risk or could potentially lead to an injury. But we have seen a small uptick in the number of the female population that is experiencing this as well. Thank you for owning that. I appreciate it. Look at this. More than 38% of our injuries are going to result from motor vehicle accidents. So whether that is a four-wheel, three-wheel, two-wheel, right, motorized vehicle. I've never met anybody injured on a unicycle, much less a motorized unicycle. You don't even see a unicycle. Do they even make them anymore? Worst idea in the world. I got it for Christmas one year. It's like, what were y'all thinking? 30% are going to be falls. So, I mean, just freak accidents. People stepping into the wrong thing at the wrong time. One of my favorite patients was a guy who was a freshman or maybe sophomore in college. But he was a big football field type of guy. He was in the front yard of his own house playing with a brand new puppy, tripped on a tree root, fell and broke his neck in his own yard. I know of a woman who went to spend the night with a friend. A friend had moved into a new home. She got up in the middle of the night to go to the bathroom, fell down the basement stairs. Another guy, a woman who was in the passenger seat of her husband's car. They drove into the mini-mart, parked. He got out of the car, went to the store. She stayed in the car. That side of the parking lot, drug deal goes bad. Guns are drawn, shots are fired. The only person who got shot was the woman sitting in her car minding her own business, paraplegic. What's the difference between quadriplegic and paraplegic?
Like the way
quadriplegic is going to be all four extremities are affected. Para is going to be two. It could be legs. It could be arms. We've seen violent-related injuries, sports-related. Does everybody remember the young man who was, I think, from Valdosta State, went to UGA last year, the year before, and right out of the gate, his very first game, spinal cord injury came to Shepherd's Eye. Think of spinal cord injuries in four different categories. It starts with the difference between quite a different pair of injuries. And then each one of those can be a complete injury or an incomplete injury. It's not a trick question. What's the difference between complete and incomplete? If this is my level of injury, I'm a complete injury. What does it say? There's nothing moving, no sensation beneath that level. More often than not, it's an incomplete injury, meaning there is something still going on. It's very rare for you to have a severed spinal cord, right? You don't have to sever the cord to have a complete injury, but it's rare. More often than not, there are more incomplete quadriplegics, tetra and quad being the same thing, and then there's incomplete paraplegics, complete paraplegics, complete quadriplegics. What would you rather be if you had to choose any of these? Anybody watch Jigsaw? Or saw one of those movies?
Oh,
what if Jigsaw said, you're going to be one of these and you're going to have to choose, which one do you want? There is a right answer. What do you want to be?
Incomplete.
Incomplete what? You want to be incomplete tetra? What about you?
I don't want to be any of them. I mean, I guess incomplete.
I think that's a wise. Nobody wants it. That's the part of the problem. Nobody left home that day thinking they were going to end up at the end of the day one of these. But if you had to, you want to be an incomplete paraplegic, right? You want as much of your hands as possible. Because any therapist is going to say, give me upper body strength, give me arms, give me hands, and we can make anything happen. Now, really, the choice is, would I want to be a quad or a para? You want to be para. You want to be the para that's got as much function as possible, right? Oh, we'll skip that. Where are we going? That is a piece of spinal cord right there. The surgeon who took that picture described it as being the consistency of an overripe banana. So if you've ever had overripe banana, you know how easy it is to squeeze. You don't even have to squeeze, but you can still leave your fingerprint, right, in the meat of it. Think of that as not a banana, but a spinal cord. That little imprint you just left could potentially cause some sort of spinal cord damage, some sort of loss of function, of movement, of sensation. It's very fragile. Now, we do a great job as human beings, because whoever made us put that spinal column as a protector down the length of it, and does a really good job. It's not easy to get a spinal cord injury.
Let me ask you a question.
Yep.
Why is that out? Why is that there?
I believe this was taken out. It wasn't an autopsy. I believe there's such a thing. Some of my patients have got reflexes. Oddly enough, you may lose movement and sensation. You don't lose reflexes. And those reflexes, you know, if you were to hit somebody on the bottom of the kneecap, they kick. Sometimes they're so hypersensitive that they end up having what's called spasms. And the spasms are so huge that literally you can see people spasm right out of the bed, out of a chair. And it would be uncommon, but there was a thought at one point, here's where we want to sever the cord. Try to put a stop to all that. I'm not even sure they do that anymore. Now look at this guy right there. All right. Everybody go home today, lay down on the floor, lay down on a bed, and concentrate on not moving anything. Right? Relax all your muscles. Right? Take some concentration. I think we all walk around a little bit more tense than we think. But think about yourself lying there at your age, being told you are a C3 complete quadriplegic. What would that mean to you? So that's right in there. And you're complete, so you feel nothing or move nothing from the neck down. Lay on that bed and think about, I can only turn my head, I can lift my head, and that's it. What kind of life is that going to be? Boring. How would you feel? Would you think that everything you had planned for yourself might be over? That I wanted to go to school, I wanted to go to college, I wanted to work, I wanted to get married, I wanted to have kids. Wouldn't you feel that way? My job is to prove you wrong. Okay? It's going to be different. It's going to be harder. still there, if you have the gumption to want to give it a try.
Right.
The point here is that every time you go down your spine, so instead of being injured C1, C2, C3, let's say you're injured at C4. Your life is going to be better. Every step you take down the cord is better because of the more function you're going to have. Okay? At C4, that's a really big moment because you're going to pick up shoulder shrug, which is fine, but really, what are you going to do with your shoulders? I can move my head, and now I can move my shoulders. What are you going to do with that? You're going to give shade? Huh? You're going to do that? More importantly, you're going to have diaphragm. What does your diaphragm do for you? Anybody?
Diaphragm.
Says what?
Speak louder
because it's doing what? It's the innervation that's going to pull your lungs down and up, right? It's going to pull air in and out. So the more air, yeah, probably increases your voice. But if you are intact at C4, chances are you are not on a ventilator. C1, 2, 3, you are. You've got a trach, and chances are you're on a ventilator for the rest of your life. Has anybody ever seen anybody on a ventilator? Your grandma? Really? Is she on one now? Yay. The next step, you go down to C5. I'm not on a ventilator. I've got my shoulder, but now I'm going to start picking up some arm muscles. Right? The first one you're going to get back is your bicep. What lets you put your arm up and toy with your hair right now? Because it does what? Pulls your arm up like this, right? Do it again. Keep it there. All right, that's your bicep. What does your bicep not keep there? What does your bicep not do? Allow you to do this. What do I need to do that? I need my tricep, right? So bicep first, tricep second. They don't come back at the same time. Bicep comes first, so if you were to walk to my hospital, you might see some folks in their beds or in their chairs looking like they're chicken winged, right? Not a bad thing. They can probably still scratch their chin, right? But they can't get their arms back down. So we actually use pillows lengths to help keep their arms in this position, because if they do this and they stay that way, it's going to freeze that way. Life's going to be a little bit more difficult for them, and it's already bad enough. You go down to the next one, you're going to start picking up your wrist muscles. Anybody excited about that? You are. Look at you doing your wrist muscle right there. Now see, I picked you. Here we go. Why is this important? Remember, the more you go down, the more function you get. And it's big there because an occupational therapist is going to say, wow, with this, I can start thinking about splints, bracing. I can maybe have a splint that will hold the end of a toothbrush. Maybe that guy can brush his own teeth now, comb his own hair, right? Maybe have a stylet and use a touch pad of some sort. That's where things really start getting interesting for some of my folks from a functional perspective. It's not until you get to C7, C8 that you start getting fingers, right? People should be really excited about picking fingers, but which one comes back first? You got five choices. Don't say the middle one. Which one would you want first? Thumb? Thumb? Yeah, it's this one that comes back, right? Interesting. These probably are the more important of all five, but this is what you got. Now, what are you going to do with your pinky? I bet you pinky squared just this morning. No, not once. Bet you do before the day's out. But think about that. What can I do with my pinky? Remember the stylet the guy had when he didn't have any finger control? Don't need the stylet anymore. I can dial a phone. I can work a keypad, right? Your therapy team's going to take whatever you've got and maximize it to whatever you can, right? What you would hope is to have the entire hand before it's over, but you don't get that until T1. T1 being right there. Any physical therapist would say, give me somebody with hands, arms, upper body strength, and we can do anything. There's actually a syndrome. It's called central cord syndrome that would leave somebody what would you rather? Would you rather be able to walk on a beautiful day or roll in a wheelchair? Would you rather be able to walk somewhere and not have use of your hands when you and arms when you get there? Or roll there and have use of your hands? The right answer is roll, right? Because you can walk all day long, but when you get to that door, what you gonna do? You can walk to the bathroom, but when you get there, what are you gonna do? A therapist would say, put him in a chair, let's work on upper body strength. When you get down to T9, T10, you're gonna pick up coughing and laughing muscles. Big deal, right? What's important about coughing? Why do we cough? Why? Get what? Absolutely. Right. We rely on our cough to pull secretions, sputum, out of our lungs, particularly when we have a cold or the flu or something, right? My folks don't have that. That's why my folks are going to be susceptible to colds turning into pneumonia. Pneumonia is the number one killer of a spinal cord patient, all because of that. Right? If my guys are T8 and above, chances are the best cough they're going to be able to give you is that. So we spend a lot of time teaching people about respiratory issues, about what things to avoid. I mean, there are things to not eat and drink that's going to cause sputum. Everybody knows Celine Dion? She does not drink milk products the day of her performance, right? Because it inherently causes more mucus production. I guess she doesn't want to honk a loogie in the middle of my heart will go on. But what can I do to help somebody who doesn't have those coughing muscles? Ever heard of assist coughing? What if I took my hands and put them together like that? Made a butterfly, put the thumbs around my patient's navel and said, patient, breathe, and on the count of three, you take the best cough you can, because I'm going to use my hands to replace your muscles, and we're going to go in and up, and we're going to knock that sputum right out of your lungs. Really effective. So simple, and yet how often does it get missed in other facilities? Over and over again. At T12, L1, L2, things are getting a little bit more interesting for you. Hips. What's important about hips? What should a physical therapist be thinking now? Can this guy stand? Can we start thinking about using braces, crutches? At some point, are we looking at mobility and walking? Maybe not at L1, standing potentially, but 2, 3, 4, you picked up all the way down to the top of your foot and your ankle. Yeah, there should be braces being put into place. The thought being, can we help you walk? It's not until S1, S2 that you get legs and feet. Everything is there now. Hopefully, no compromises. Everything is there. But you're still neurologically damaged, because if you're injured at C3, you've lost 3, 4, and 5. You no longer have control of your bowel, bladder, or sexual function. You're up and walking, but you're going to be dealing with incontinence. How do you think people feel about all this? I'm a younger person's hospital, so I see a lot of people your age. How would y'all feel about any of this? Are you happy? Are you sad? Are you depressed? Are you angry? Who are you angry at? Yourself, maybe. Is it easier to be angry at me or you? Yeah, sometimes you see a lot of folks acting out and trying to push people away for a whole lot of reasons. A lot of folks are going to start thinking of themselves as a burden, right? I don't want to be a burden to my family. I'm going to act as bad as possible and push y'all away on purpose, right? A whole lot of psychology goes into this kind of thing. A whole lot of emotional upheaval. Every patient is assigned a counselor. They have the opportunity, if needed, for psychology and psychiatry consults. We use an awful lot of antidepressants. We have a huge peer support network. Right? A lot of time is spent on just emotion and thought process. Because if you get mired down in depression and don't have the inclination to get up and start participating in a therapy program, you don't get to stay. It's almost as though you're saying, I'm picking dependence right here, right now. And we're going to take you on your word, and chances are you're going to be discharged to home, maybe. Nursing home, possibly. Care facility, Do most people want to go home?
Yes.
Most. Sadly, it's not always the best place. It's not always the safest place somebody. I'll tell you a story about a young man who was y'all's age, and he, tell you more, high school, when did y'all graduate high school? In the brain?
Couple years.
Y'all be careful on high school graduation night, it's a bad night. This guy was, went out with friends on high school graduation, and he ended up as a quadriplegic. I went into his room one day, and he was angry. He was just about the angriest kid I've ever seen. And who was he angry at? Everybody, the world. And his mom was sitting there. I remember she had some glasses on her nose, and she was crocheting or knitting or something, and he was cussing up in the street at her, just up and down one side or the other. And she wasn't even looking at him. She was just doing her thing. And I walked in and caught it all, and I was standing behind her, and I looked at him and said, "What are you doing?" And then he turned it on me. And interestingly, when he wasn't yelling at her, but now me, she put her stuff in her purse, she stood up and said, "I've just decided you're not coming home. I'm not going to spend the rest of my life having you talk to me this way or watch you talking to anybody else this way." And she walked out. Shut him down fully. What do you think? I think as a mom, that was a really hard thing to do. Yeah. But from his perspective, think about where he's coming from. He had graduated high school. What is high school typically at the end of? Childhood. He was going to college. He was about to be a young adult, right? And now he saw himself as forever a child in her home. Right? He went to a care facility. I saw him a year later. His mom came in, and they had patched their relationship. And it was probably the best move that could have happened because he got to develop into an adult. It wasn't at home. She invited him to come home. He said, "No. It may not be my first choice, but here I'm an adult. And I'm not going to be a burden on your doorstep." Right? A whole lot of our thought goes into this. I'll just skip some of this. You know, talking about the central cord syndrome, the one that left you unable to use your arms but use your legs, it comes in other different sizes and shapes too. It matters. If everybody in this room was suddenly injured at the same level, that doesn't mean we have the same functional level, right? Injury level, yes, functional, no. Because it's going to matter. Are you injured completely through the cord? Were you injured only on the front, the back, the sides, exterior, interior? It all creates a different presentation when it comes to what your capability is going to be. How about if you had the ability to move this arm, but didn't know where it was in space if you closed your eyes? Right? You had no sensation over here. I know where this arm is on this side, but I can't move it. There is such a thing. Right? Are there people who have sensation and no movement? Yeah. Movement and no sensation. Yeah, which would you rather? Neither one's a great condition. At least if you had sensation, you would know if you were developing some sort of a skin problem, if you've been on the spot too long. Everybody has probably shifted at least once and you came in here. Even though this is the most riveting conversation you've ever had, you're still moving. And you do it without even thinking, because if you sit on one spot too long, it doesn't start to hurt, so you shift. My folks can't do this. And if they don't shift, they're going to sit too long and they're going to cause themselves a pressure injury. And we will see that soon. This young lady has broken her neck. Her spine is subluxed, meaning it used to be like this, and now it's like this. So we got to get that spine back into alignment. We're going to put Gardner Well tongs on her head. There's actually a pin on each side that is screwed into her scalp, into her skull. Right? There is the rope to the pulley, and then there's a certain amount of weight here. And we're going to keep putting weight there until we can see by x-ray that the bones are back into alignment. I saw somebody with 80 pounds of weight stuck to their head like this. Now the problem, he was a very small framed guy, about 120 pounds, and he kept being drugged up the bed and almost out the top of it. They had to come up with a different plan, and he went to surgery a whole lot faster because of it. Is that person awake? She looks like she is. Alert? Do you think she's in pain? Well, it's a nice drawing. Yeah. She is probably in a lot of pain. One, she's got all this weight on her head pulling her this way. I suppress her and her ability to breathe properly, right? I could suppress her into respiratory failure if I'm not careful, right? If I suppress her too far, she may end up pooling secretions that turn into a pneumonia. This young man also broke his neck, but he is not subluxed. He is still in alignment, and they are using this device, his Halo Vest, to keep his neck in alignment because all he needs is time to heal. Those bones are going to fix themselves, but he is going to wear this bad boy for probably 6 to 8 weeks. He's got a metal ring around the top. There are four posts, two in front, two in the back, four screws this time into his head, and then he is wearing this vest to keep it all in place. He's going to be a little less complicated in some ways. The person who did go to surgery is wearing that. It's a hard collar. You're wearing that because you need the stability to keep your neck in alignment while everything's healing post-surgery. They've gone in and they've actually fused things together. They may have put hardware in there to resupport the structure. But 6 weeks at a minimum, yes. If that mannequin were a real patient and the head of the bed was up, he was wearing that collar. Why? Because that collar is supposed to keep that chin up, right? I had a nursing student come in and worked with a patient who was wearing that collar, was up in bed, and he said to this young lady, "It's so hot in here, would you take off the front of my collar and just wipe the front of my neck down?" What would a prudent person say? Say, yes, I'll do that, or no, I don't know if I should do that. Let me go find somebody first. That's the right answer. And as you move forward in life, think about that. If I have not done this before, why am I doing it now? It will not fail you. I'll always count to 10. She said, no, let me go find your nurse. And he said, oh, don't worry about that. We do this every single day. You can tell for yourself how hot it is on this side of the building in July. And she said, oh, well, okay. She takes off the front of the collar, his chin hits his chest, and she says, I hear popping and cracking, so I call for help. Now, they took him down to x-ray, and it turned out that everything was fine, but what if he had been a non-neurodeficit, right? Meaning everything was intact, all his problems were bone, and she took that brace off, and the quick movement of that head turned into some sort of paralysis, permanent. But he had a lot to live with, right, and almost cursed somebody to live with, too. What she didn't know is that all she had to do with somebody there would have been to lower the head of the bed, keep him in a neutral position, take the front of the collar off, clean it, wash his neck, put it back with somebody there, log roll him over, take the back off, do the same thing. Everything would have been hunky-dory. But sometimes you don't know what you don't know, right? Don't be the person who finds out, well, I didn't know that. These two guys did not have cervical surgery. Their problem was more thoracic lumbar, so more along the middle line of the back. They've gone and they have opened up an incision, and they have literally put in metal bars and adhered them to the broken pieces of the vertebra, right? So they're gonna have a large surgical incision. It's gonna be a very painful surgery because of the territory that's involved, and they are wearing this TLSO brace. Right, this one is a hard shell, front and back, but either one, this one is an open design. But all they're meant to do is to remind you, now's not the time to be moving forward or pulling back. It's all about keeping yourself in alignment. Let's talk about some of the things we take for granted. Sorry, there. If I am a complete injury at my cervical level, there's some things that are going on. Well, there's some things not going on, they used to be, right? We take a lot for granted. This movement we're doing, off the table now, right? I am going to not sweat underneath the level of my injury. I'm not going to make goose flesh or shiver, right? My parasympathetic and sympathetic systems are no longer in the same happy relationship they were, right? They're both fighting for dominance now. My heart rate is typically going to be lower than what we may be standing here with. They're going to be more bradycardic. What's bradycardic? What rate would you define somebody as being bradycardic? 60 and below, right? What's the typical heart rate?
I'm sorry, I don't know. Regular
excitement of the holidays. So somewhere between 60 and 90. I would say 60 is on borderline low, 90 too high. So let's say 80, right? What would you think of as a typical blood pressure? What's normal blood pressure?
I have random.
What is it?
120
over 80. Everybody's heard that number before? I would expect my guy to be hypotensive. Maybe 90 over 60 now. Because one of the things that's not happening beneath your level of injury is you're not constricting and dilating anymore. I did that backwards. You're not constricting and dilating anymore, right? All you're doing is dilating. There's nothing there to squeeze those vessels and force blood back up to the higher extremities. If you jumped out of your chair today and you didn't have the ability to dilate and constrict, only dilate, you might pass out. All right? It's called orthostatic hypotension. We see it a lot in our patients. Right? They have to be cautioned about wearing an abdominal binder or ACE wraps around their legs to help with edema and literally to push fluid back up. Some of my folks are going to end up on medication specifically to elevate their blood pressure. Because of the lack of mobility, because of the lack of sensation, because of the lack of constriction, I'm setting my guy up for a deep vein thrombosis, a blood clot in his legs, right? Anybody know what four signs and symptoms of having a blood clot are? Yes. If I've got a clot, blood's going down to the bottom, but now I can't get back up. What's the first thing I should see?
Swelling,
right? Swelling at some point might cause pain, might cause a fever, might cause redness in that area, right? What's the problem if I want to rely on my patient's ability to tell me if they're in pain in their lower extremities? They may not feel it, right? So I can't count on that. What if their skin is of a tone that doesn't show redness particularly well? Can't count on that. So now, should I be putting my hands on their thighs, their calves, to see if there's any difference in heat? Right now, if one has been under a blanket and one has not been, then this one's hotter, so that makes sense. But if I took the blanket off and gave them about 30 minutes, would I feel the same body temperature? Should. If I don't, if I start to see some noticeable swelling here and not here, I'm going to be calling the doctor because there's a blood clot in place and it could break loose and kill that guy. Right? That's a medical emergency. Your GI system is going to be working half its speed. So what you put in 48 hours ago, we may not see for another 48 hours. Right? Everything is shut down, particularly around the initial injury, and then comes back slowly. Here's something fun. You can use this word at Christmas time. Mom, Dad, I think I've been given a huge gift of poikilothermism. Isn't that a big word? All that means is, remember, no shivering, no sweating beneath the level of injury, which is going to make you more cold-blooded, if you will. You're going to take on the temperature of the environment you happen to be in. So you're going to be very susceptible to a cold room or an overly hot room. If you're in a cold room, let's say my patient fell through the ice and fell into the proverbial lake. What's going to happen? You're going to go into hypothermia. What's one of the hallmarks of hypothermia? Does your heart rate go up or down? Go down, right? Respirations go down. Remember, my patient already has bradycardia because of his injury. And now if I put him in too cold a room, does it go down even further? Yeah, that could turn into a real crisis real fast. At some point, you count on your heart rate to be a certain rate to get perfusion to your entire body, right? And if you don't do it, you're putting everything at risk. The same can be said if you go into a patient's room and it's too hot in there. You know, the guy wasn't complaining for nothing about the heat. I would be surprised if he wasn't on the verge of running a fever. And at some point, what level of fever will turn into a seizure? And people die on both sides of this equation. Bowel and bladder. Most of my patients, if not for a moment, forever, will be incontinent. Right? They have no control. They don't know when they need to go. They can't initiate going. They can't go efficiently, and they can't stop if they wanted to. Everybody seen the commercial with the woman on the golf course? Gotta go, gotta go, gotta go. Right? Well, maybe we're watching different channels. I don't know. But the problem can be you're not doing those four things appropriately. Sometimes it's not just about urgency. It's the fact that I can't. an efficient idea at all. So we could all be in here, we could all have some form of incontinence because we think we know when we need to go to the bathroom. We can control when you go to the bathroom. We can stop going to the bathroom if we wanted to. But who tells us? How do we know if we've been efficient? How do we know if we've emptied our bladders? Has anybody ever done a post-void residual on you? Has anybody ever done a bladder scan on you? No? Who knows? We're going to maintain that if you're unable to void, self-void, chances are you're going to be doing some straight cathing for the rest of your life, meaning every 4 to 6 hours dropping a catheter and emptying your bladder. There'll be another approach as far as bowel, right? We're going to have to find some pattern and some intervention that removes what needs to be removed if you can't do it on your own volition. You think people are happy about that? You feel bad enough about not being able to walk, and now you're telling me I'm going to spend the rest of my life potentially soiling myself at any turn, right? There's not a lot of joy to be found in these injuries, right? It's our job to help put into place some education, some tools to help put control back into your hands, right? Skin. What is that?
Y'all know what that is?
Lady in the green, what is that? That's you.
I don't know. She don't like to look at those pictures. She always gets sick. What is it? You know what that is.
It's a bed sore. That's not just a bed sore. That's a grade 4 all the way down to the bone pressure ulcer.
Can you tell what area that is?
No.
What?
Leg.
Her butt?
I prefer a medical term. That is her sacral ischial area. That is one fold. That's the butt. That's the thigh on her left side. And here would be the other fold. And her rectum is right there. Okay? Now this one's got a lot of trouble on her hands. Right? They've taken her into surgery already. They have cleaned this wound. It's been debrided. Right? They want all that pink, healthy flesh exposed. She's going back and she's going to have surgery because I'm going to have to close this now. But I bet money she ends up with a colostomy for at least a period of time because there's no way for her to do her bowel programs and not soil this over and over and over again. What's interesting about this woman is this is not her first injury. See that line right there? That's where it happened on the other side. And it's been fixed. That is somebody not being cared for appropriately. Does that happen in homes? Nursing homes, hospitals. Yeah, absolutely. It's a big deal, particularly in a hospital or a care facility, because y'all are responsible. And no insurance company is going to pay for this. Hospital's going to pay for this because it happened on your watch. We told the story earlier about a woman in a hospital here in Lower Georgia. Had an accident, went to the emergency room. Nurse inventoried everything that she came in with, all her clothing, one earring on, one earring missing. She went to surgery. 10 days later, she's in the ICU. Nurse comes in to care for her for the first time, does a head-to-toe assessment, turns her, and finds a wound, not like that, not as big, but it went all the way down to the bone. She didn't come in with this. This happened in the hospital. They took it to surgery, cleaned it out, and what did they find? The missing earring. She'd been laying on it, and it had embedded itself to such an extent that it caused damage all the way down to the bone. Every nurse who charted skin dry and intact from the minute she came in the door to that minute it was found was fired on time. Right? You don't chart something you say you did when you didn't do it. And you don't chart what somebody else told you they saw. I have a lot of new grads fall into that. There's another one. That young man was left on his hip too long. And pressure just took all the flesh all the way down to the bone. Gone. He'll be going to surgery as well. These are about $250,000 surgeries. They're huge amounts of money for something that should have been preventable. And you can do everything we ask you to do. You can take every precaution. You might still end up with a skin breakdown, but it should not get to that level. My goodness, no. Let's look at, this young girl. That is a friend of mine. She was a nursing student when this was taken. She and her sorority and fraternity friends decided to go to the lake. I think it was Lake Lacuna. And the frat guy said, look at all this black plastic sheeting. Let's make a homemade slip and slide. On a what could go wrong? That's her up in the air, arms behind her, head thrown out. She's about to go into that water head first with no protection.
Look at that guy right there by the boat.
Look at this guy. How much water is he in? She went in with all the function of the world, came out as C2 vent impending water bleeding. Nothing from the neck down. Now she's a miracle case. She made a full recovery because she didn't have spinal cord injury. She had spinal shock. Her system sustained no lasting injury. What her system took was a wallop that shut everything down as though she were in spinal cord injury. And she said it was a really frightening time because she was in nursing school. She knew enough to recognize I'm in trouble bad. But she said it was so frightening because every day she'd wake up and think, will I get something else? And it went on for 6-7 weeks before she had everything come back. She is a lucky, lucky girl. That does not happen often. Let's look at this young lady. What do we see there? Would you say she's a para or a quad?
Para.
Why do you say para?
She's doing it wrong.
Okay, so is that a para or an incomplete quad? Part of the clue is the size of chair she's in. That's a mechanical chair. You would hope that a paraplegic, not always, but more often than not, is in a push chair. So that tells me she doesn't have the ability in these arms to push herself. You can't see so clearly from back here, but if you saw her hands up close, you would notice that her fingers are in some fairly odd positioning. It doesn't look as though she has the ability to do much more than this, right? So that is a therapeutic recreationist. It's his job to ask her, tell me what you enjoyed. When you weren't in school, when you weren't working, when you weren't asleep, did you enjoy sports? What hobbies and crafts did you do? Let's go out and see if we can do some of this stuff again. So I'm guessing she expressed some interest in basketball. Oh, that's Frosty, the therapy dog. Everybody go, oh, it's Frosty. Our swimming pool, blah, blah, blah. But look at this guy. That is Dr. Murray. He's the attending physician for the adolescent spinal cord team. So all these folks are probably between 14 and, I guess, 25. Okay? Each one of them has a spinal cord injury. What is this gentleman right here? Para or quad? You got a 50% chance of getting it right.
Quad.
He's a quad. What makes you say so? He's in a power chair. Not a lot of girls, just a different view. But to your point, you see the hand rests. They've put little straps around his arms to keep him there, so I'm going to bet he has some spasm problems. But his fingers, do those look like he has control of them, or have they just been positioned that way?
Yes.
Look, he's got a hard collar on around his neck. See that trach? He's on a ventilator. He's on a portable ventilator. That little straw right there is developed. It can do all sorts of things. If you sip on it, it does one thing. If you puff on it, it does something else. I guarantee you he does one of those and makes the entire chair kick backwards so that he can do a weight shift every 30 minutes to make sure that he's not sitting on the same spot continuously. He does the other sip or puff, and it brings him back up. What about that guy right back in there? What do you think about him? That's not such a good picture, but I'll tell you, he's in the same type of power chair. So I'm guessing he's a quadriplegic. It doesn't look like he's been on a ventilator because there's nothing around his neck. Same can be said for this guy right here, right? But he's got that sort of flaccid hand right there. I'd be surprised if he wasn't compromised. The man back there, he's got a black strap across his chest. He's got little wings, and they're meant to give him trunk support so he can sit upright. He's got a hard collar, so he's had surgery, I bet. This guy, the class earlier thought they recognized this guy.
Yeah, do y'all know who that is?
That's him. Yeah, maybe it is. Oh, it is.
Austin Witten.
Yeah.
Jumped in the pool. Mm-hmm.
So, I would have guessed maybe either an incomplete quad or a para, because it looks like he's got use of his fingers. It doesn't look like he's in a powered chair, but he might have been a very incomplete quadriplegic, particularly knowing that he jumped into a swimming pool. That's probably what's happening there. Look at this gentleman right here. That's a power chair. Look at his hands. It doesn't look like he has the ability to extend his fingers. There's a bandage on his throat, so he had a trach, and they pulled it, and it's healing over. These white stockings he's wearing there, here, those are to help with edema in his lower extremities, not pool. Like the guy in the white shirt back there, power chair, there's that chest strap. He's got a trach, he's got a collar, there's the vent. See the tubing there? People get up every single day, and they have attendants that bathe them, groom them, dress them, put them in these power chairs, hook up their power ventilator, and they leave home and they go to school, or they go to work. It takes a lot of bravery, don't you think, to leave home and know that if something goes wrong and I can't get somebody to help me quickly, it could go real bad real soon. This guy doesn't look like he's got a scar or a bandage on his neck, so I'm guessing he was never trached, but again, it looks like he is in a power chair of some sort. Look at the expressions on all these guys, though. Look at that. That's a big smile. Look at that. That thumbs up. These guys are taking it pretty well, don't you think? And I think that's the amazing thing of working in a facility where it's a younger patient population. Not that they took this in stride, but I think at some point, y'all, not me, have the ability to say, this sucks, but I'm not going to live the rest of my life defined by this injury. There's things I want to do. And by golly, look at these faces. They're going to go out there and do it. It's really, it's an amazing place. That's my car in the setting. See, there's somebody there with a therapist they're working on walking. This is Pete Anziano. Great guy. He is in a peer support program. He's a counselor for us. And he was injured on a motorcycle. He was riding in the North Georgia mountains. I imagine not far from where we are. Hit some a patch of wet leaves in the road. Threw him off his bike. He landed on a concrete pylon. Left him as a paraplegic. Now, he's a very incomplete para. I can tell you from knowing him. He can stand, but he cannot walk easily, if at all. I've seen him stand. I've never seen him walk, but he put that way. But look at what he's wearing. You can't tell because of the color of his shirt, but there is some significant binder going there. On the back, I guarantee you there's a larger battery pack that's there. And then he has this, what is called, exoskeleton, right? So he's got these splints going all the way down each leg. And he's using canes for support. That is the result of just some groundbreaking research. That is going to allow him to initiate a step. Now, it's only going to be useful to somebody who has at least hip flexion. If hip flexion was around L1, right? T12 L1. Just say yeah.
Yeah.
Right. So, it's made in such a way that, yes, he's using those cranes to support himself, but because he can initiate a hip flexion, right, so if he were to pop his right hip forward, that device will help him take a step forward. He does the other one, and it goes like that. Now, he's not going to be running races, but do you think that's important to somebody who's been sitting in a wheelchair for years to finally be able to get up and start taking some walks of your own volition? That's brilliant. I saw a guy at a conference. He and I chatted for a good 20 minutes. He was in a chair, not unlike Peter's, right, little push chair. He went around the corner. The Indigo folks happened to be on the other side of my curtain. He came back walking with us, not 30 minutes later, and the look on his face was unbelievable. Now, the problem is that costs about $70,000. Paydays, thank God, paydays today. I was about to say, I don't have $7. I'm doing now. How do we get the price down so more people can afford that? Here's where I feel old again. Does everybody remember a VCR? That's what we had before DVRs. Do you remember the very first wave of them? Did your grandma have one maybe that was maybe this big, this tall, and it sat on that giant console television? That's how they first came to us. They were about $800 or $900. Mine was $800. I bought it at Macy's. Before it was over, you could buy a VCR at Kroger for $19.95. Now, how did they go from $800 down to
$20?
Advanced, but everybody in the world wanted one, right? Did you ever go into a home at one point that didn't have a VCR? The more they want, the more research went into it, the better the product, the cheaper they were able to produce it. The problem for this is how many people are going to want and need this? As many as people as wanted a VCR? No, this is going to be a very finite group of folks. So I don't know that we ever find a way to get that price down so that it's actually more affordable. that's twice as much as my car. But if it helped me get out of that chair, would I sell and hawk everything I had? I'd certainly do my best. That is a nurse in the ICU. You can tell that patient he is newly injured. He has not even started the rehab program yet. He is on a ventilator. It looks like, you just see it right there, he's not on it at the moment. They're doing some trial testing to see if he can come off. But he's got tube feeding. He's got IV pumps going on. He's on cardiac telemetry, right? But even in the ICU, if that patient were in that big halo vest, if he was nasally or orally intubated, if he was trached, if he had a IJ line, if he had bilateral chest tubes, if he had a colostomy, Foley, broken arms with splints, casts on his legs, that man still gets out of bed. If you are hemodynamically stable and orthopedically stable, we take advantage of this time to start working on out of bed. Therapists actually start working with folks there, because the doctor's going to come in one morning and say, you're ready for rehab. He's going to write an order, and the next thing you know, you're out of the ICU, you're out of the gymnasium where they expect you to be working 4 to 6 hours a day. And if we haven't started something in the ICU, we have set you up for failure. And anything we can get at this point is claimed as medical dollars, not rehab dollars. Everybody has some limit as to how much rehabilitation your carrier is willing to pay for you. Most people have about 30 days of rehab. My average length of stay is 35 to 45 days. Right now we're running around 55 days. So if they're only going to cover 30, what do I do about the other days? Do I get paid for it? If my case manager can go to that payer and say, you know what, we've run out of rehab days, but here's what the team has on the table, here are the things they think they can achieve, we think it will save you money in the long run, they're going to fund that patient to stay as long as they're making progress, and as long as they know we're making progress towards something that inevitably will make life cheaper. Sometimes it comes down to dollars and cents, kids. Look at these two guys. Tell me about this, the girl in the orange. What do we know about her? She was indeed, right? So she still has her trach, and they have taken her off, and they are doing some trials. I imagine she is off during the day, maybe some at night, but they are no doubt keeping track of how she's doing to make sure that her blood gases are still good. Is she a para or a quad? 50% chance. She's a quad, right? Look at her hand. It doesn't appear as though she has got the ability to flex her fingers, right? She's not in a power chair that he is in. She's in a push chair, so that tells me that she's actually got a lot of upper body strength and movement of those arms. And she no doubt has a chair, but she may not be able to grasp the wheels and the roll, but I guarantee you they've got some devices on there, so she's pushing it with her forearms as opposed to that. Now this guy, he's a power chair. He's got a little red cap, so they're working on, he's close to having that trach pulled, because that red button there, that's the last step before they pull it. And it's over. Is that what it
is? Matt, attention please. There will be no soccer this afternoon. No soccer. And soccer practice will resume after Christmas. It will resume after Christmas.
Nobody seems excited. So what else do we know about this guy?
Miss McQueen?
Yes.
I need Tina Jones to sign out.
Okay.
Thank you.
So he's in a power chair. It doesn't look like he's got flexion in his fingers. He's got those paddles right there that are to help stay him in that chair upright. Right. I would guess he's a very high level quadriplegic. But again, look at these faces. Young people, y'all got it. Hang on to it as long as you can, because the older my patients get, the harder it is for them to bounce back from things like this. I had a patient one day who was, he and his wife retired on Friday. They packed, they got into their car on Saturday morning to go to their retirement home in Florida. Never made it. Quadriplegic, not an hour outside of town. Traffic accident. How do you think he felt? He'd worked all his life, and literally the first day of retirement, tragedy. It was a game changer for all of them. There's a therapist working with a paraplegic on upper body strength. This gentleman is, what do we think? compare or what? He's in a push chair.
He's got a brace.
It looks like he's got a brace across his waist there. I bet he has spasms. He's got a sliding board in his backpack right there. And that is either he's being taught how to do it independently, or that is part of his caretaker's technique to get him from that chair to a bed or to a toilet. You're going to put one end of the sliding board under a butt cheek, put the other end wherever you're headed, and you're going to start sliding down that chair to get where you want to go. Blah, blah, blah. There are my dogs. Zombie, dachshunds, and poodle. Questions? That should have taken us about 2 hours, so we were moving pretty fast. Questions about anything? If you leave here doing one thing different, put your seatbelts on. Don't drive distracted. How many people text and drive?
She's up here.
Really? What happened?
Mom didn't buckle her upright in the seat, and they slipped on a block of black ice, and when they did, it wrecked, and it flew her out, and she broke her spine or something else. And she's she can move her arms, so she has one of those boards that she can get out and then pull in.
Good girl.
And she can swim.
Yay. I bet you there was a time when she thought she'd never swim again. I tell you what, I met a young man who was injured surfing in the ocean. He fell off his board. The board clipped him on the back of the head, left him as a functioning quadriplegic. His therapy team took a surfboard and they carved channels in it so he could lay on the board, take his forearms, push into those channels, lift his head up, and they took him back down. That's pretty brilliant. Happy holidays to y'all, because I can feel the song coming right now. I've got these little anatomically incorrect things over here with which you may remember me by.